All right, guys, you know we like to have fun on this channel, and something we're about to do here is kind of silly. We got 150 pounds of binary explosives loaded into a tree here. I'm going to show you my version of a toothpick factory. This binary was provided in courtesy of USA chemicalsupply.com. This is going to be a lot of fun. Oh yeah, that's what we call a pop shot. You know, just reach out from behind a tree, take a shot with your 308, and wreck a few cameras in the process. Holy crap. Well, I know some tree hugging hippie's gonna give me hell for this one, but they'll get over it. Welcome back, everybody. This is Eric and Chad here, Moss Pond and Gun. Today we have another gun gripe for you. I hope that you guys enjoyed that nice binary explosion at the beginning of the video there. We blew that tree up in Indiana at Tim's place. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was about ready to fall down anyways. We just helped it along a little
bit.
Yeah,
the tree was a little rotten. It wasn't alive, so I think that thing came apart quite nicely. Today, guys, we're going to be talking about ammunition hoarders. Guys that are buying up 22 and trying to, you know, sell it and profit and all this sort of thing. But before we get into that, I'm going to tell you why we came to this conclusion for doing this particular gun gripe episode. We recently put out a Facebook posting where we said, look, you guys give us your gun gripe ideas, and whoever's gun gripe idea that we select, we'll do a video on it, and you win a certificate to get a Kel-Tec PMR-30 at direct sale, direct from the Kel-Tec factory, and at an extreme discount. Mm-hmm. All right, so Mike, you're the guy that's going to get that certificate for giving us this gun gripe idea. Without further ado, we are going to discuss it, though. Now, this is something that, to be honest with you, I've been a little bit jaded about.
Yep.
So, I mean, how would we be jaded over this?
Well, because, I mean, we are a retail establishment, and when we get 22 ammo in, I mean, we do limit it to customers because we want all of our customers to have availability of that ammunition.
Sure.
Now, we do have people coming in, they want to buy, like, a whole case. I mean, at one point, we did have a few cases of Aguila ammunition in, and people wanted to buy it, and we just couldn't do it because we needed to keep it for, you know, for our other customers. But you have like these big box retailers where folks will go in and early in the morning when they know they're going to stock or whatever, and this is just one point. But you got these people that go in there and they buy up all the ammo, okay? They may limit it to like four boxes. Well, they bring five people with them. So they buy everything on the shelf or whatever they can get, come back later in the day, and they might buy the rest. If somebody else is out there on the floor, because you know how the big boxes are, same person's not going to be in the same location for that long during the day.
Sure.
Majority of the time.
Sure.
But not only that, but, I mean, even workers at the facilities, too. You know, I've heard a lot of stories, even one earlier today, about a manager at a big box store actually hoarding ammunition in the back for himself. 6,000 rounds. He was taking it off the shelf, stashing it for himself to purchase.
Yeah.
So,
well, here's a good example. Okay, with the whole big box store thing, it kind of sucks, but that's just the nature of that. You're going to get that with big box stores. My wife and I were at a big box store the other day, and they happened to have some CCI mini mags out on the shelf for sale.
It was a grand opening sale.
It was a grand opening sale.
They had a lot of 22 in.
They did. They had a lot of 22 on the shelf. And they were limiting people to, I think it was ten sleeves per person per day. So 10 100-round sleeves, basically you could buy 1,000 rounds at one time per person per day. So, you know, since I liked that ammo and I wanted some of it, I bought two sleeves or two bricks, and my wife bought two bricks. When we got up to check out, the lady was asking us, she's like, well, I noticed people are buying a lot of this 22 ammo, and she's like, why are people buying so much 22 ammo? Why do you need so much 22 ammo? And I was kind of thinking, why is she asking me? And I told the lady, I said, look, do you realize how much ammo a 15-year-old shoots out of a Ruger 10/22 in one sitting?
A lot.
In one day? I said, lady, he'll go through 500 rounds in one day.
Hell, we did it when we first started shooting. We'd get a brick of Federal. I mean, this is one you could buy it for, you know, $15 a brick. Right. We just kind of started plinking around, but we'd go out and we'd run through a whole brick and be looking at the bottom of the box going, where the hell did all of our ammo go?
It goes quick. I mean, people don't realize that when you're shooting 22 ammo, it's such a cost-saving method. When you're shooting 22, it's so much cheaper. It's easy to go through 500 rounds of ammo in a day and not realize
sure
it.
Sure is.
And the sad part is that our establishment, they go, okay, well you're considered a domestic terrorist if you have thousands of rounds of ammunition. Well, define thousands of rounds. Thousands of rounds could be 2,000 rounds. That's only 3 or 4 bricks of 22. That ain't a lot of dang ammo. You want to talk about a lot of ammo? Why don't you try 60,000 rounds? That's a lot of ammo.
And there are people out there that have stockpiles of ammo like that, and it's not because they're domestic terrorists. It's because they like to shoot. They want to get a lot of ammo at a decent price to last them several years.
That's right.
You know, that's the only thing. We buy up ammo when we can, just to not really stockpile it, but we use it a lot for the videos. I mean, sure. You see how much ammo we shoot in these videos.
Now, buy it cheap and stack it deep.
Pretty much.
That's the saying. So getting back to this whole thing about 22 ammo hoarding. Well, I mean, define hoarding. Now, my thing is that we are in a free market society. Okay, it is a capitalist-based society. It is a supply and demand-based society. That's how our economy, as of now, works. So if I go into a shop and I buy ammo as much as they'll let me buy, that is between the seller at the shop and the person purchasing the ammunition. Now, for what reasons are they buying this ammunition? Okay, well, if somebody comes in, and let's say that I get the feeling that they're trying to buy it to resell it. As long as they're buying it at the quantities that we've set forth in our shop, that's really on them, whatever they decide they're going to do.
I mean, we don't really have the right to judge, you know, the customer. They're coming in to spend money. They're buying at the limit that they are allowed to buy. And we don't really have any reason, nor do we have any right to question that.
Right.
Okay.
Now, with that being said, all right, do they have the right to resell it? Well, here's the thing, guys. I think it's a little unethical to buy ammo at a reduced cost and then try to pump it up online and sell it for some exuberant amount of money.
Now,
with that being said, it's just as much the fault of the people that are buying the ammo at the inflated price as it is the people that are willing to sell it.
Yep.
All right, if you are willing to pay $100 for a brick of 22 ammo, you're just as much of the problem as you are the person selling it. Mm-hmm. If we just refuse to buy ammo at that price, then it won't be a problem.
Yep.
Now, the issue is you have people that are independently wealthy, they have tons of money, and all they know is, all right, I want a lot of 22 ammo. They don't care what it costs. It's convenient for them to go on a website like GunBroker and go, okay, here's 20,000 rounds of 22 ammo. Okay, well, they work out the math and it's like $90 a brick. Mm-hmm. Who cares? If you're a Uber millionaire, you're loaded. Some people just don't care. They want the convenience of not having to wait in the line at the stores, not having to go around and look for it, not having to fight people over in a line. They want to go on there, click the button, and then 4 days later, they've got 20,000 rounds of 22 ammo sitting on the front porch.
Well, that extra cost is worth their time that they saved having to actually go around to different stores, hunt that ammunition down, buy in the appropriate quantities that are allowed, and then stock that ammo up. I mean, it could have taken 6 months to find 20,000 rounds of ammunition, if not longer than that.
Well,
but it goes back to like the Sandy Hook tragedy, okay? After that, I mean, I'm sure most of you guys remember, you saw like 1,000 round cases of like M855 ball, typically about $400 to $450 bucks, going for like $1,200 to $1,300
over a dollar a shot.
Over a dollar a shot.
Yeah.
$1.30 to $1.40 a shot, give or take. And people were buying it because they were scared. It was a supply and demand thing. They thought that the supply was going to dry up or whatever because there was going to be a new ban coming out and the whole nine yards. And that's just scare buying. It's just like when hurricanes pass through, okay?
Yeah.
Like in Florida, all right? You have people that come up to local big box stores, like the big hardware stores stuff. They buy up generators, they buy up plywood, they buy cases of water, all kinds of supplies that people in the storm aftermath are going to need. They take it to those storm areas or those damaged areas or whatnot, and they sell it for 3 to 4 times the face value. And people buy it because it's a supply and demand problem.
And they need it.
You need it. They got it. Fork over $1,200 for a little, 400 or 500 watt inverter generator because you got to have it to survive down there. And, it's a sucky situation, but like you said, it's just as much the problem of the buyer as the seller. But in a situation like that, it's kind of like a necessity.
Well, people are always going to remember the guys that gouged the crap out of them.
Oh, yeah.
When all this stuff was going on.
Oh, yeah.
Now, on firearm sales, I can sort of understand to a degree, like, you know, if you've got 10 ARs and this whole group of people are clamoring over these ARs and your dealers are going to come in, your local competition is going to come in and buy them for what you have on the tag and then upcharge them.
Yep.
Well, you kind of have to go with the flow on that. But ammunition, I mean, right now, we're not in a fear buying and panic buying. I don't think it's panic buying is why 22 is drying up like it is. I think that the 22 is drying up because, you know, a lot of these people are buying it up and they're either sitting on it or they're speculating on it to resell it.
Yep.
Now, I'll tell you right now that I have personally in my possession probably in excess of around 15 or 16,000 rounds of 22, which is not a lot of 22.
But, you know, that ammunition, we got in some CCI Blazer a very long time ago before any of the scare buying or any of this kind of crap came up. This was 3 years ago when we stocked up on some of that ammunition. We got it at a hell of a deal,
yeah,
and we bought pretty much everything the guy had.
Yeah.
You know, and CCI Blazer, just lead nose ammo.
Yeah.
And we've been sitting on, you know, we don't do a whole lot of 22 shooting, just like in videos or whatnot, and we've just kind of been sitting on it. We don't shoot that much 22.
Now, however, with that being said, you know, recently, you know, something kind of affected me a bit. I had an older fellow and his grandson come in, and they were looking for some 22 ammo. We didn't have hardly any on the shelf for sale. And, of course, getting 22 ammo is a real chore right now. So I kind of made an executive decision. I went through my stash at home, and I got several boxes. I mean, I had some of this Federal Champion here, and got several boxes of Federal Champion out of my collection of 22, and I brought it in and put it on the shelf to sell. Not because I'm trying to profit, but because I want the ammo to be available for people that need it.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that was very important, just from a standpoint of principle, that we're a gun shop and I have so many 22 rifles over here on the wall for sale, but not around a 22 to sell my customers. And then, you know, that little kid thinking, well, I can't go shooting this weekend because we don't have any 22 ammo. And there's just no excuse for that.
Yep.
So I went out of my way. I wanted to bring this ammo in and make sure we had something to put on the shelf. And I will continue to. If the ammo is not there, if we can't get it from the distributor, then I'll pull that out of my personal stock and I'll bring it up here and we'll sell it.
Mm-hmm.
But people have got to have ammo to take their kids shooting. And to me, that's the most important thing.
I mean,
we've even had kids come through here and I'll give them bits of my ammo. If their parents can't afford it or if they can't afford it, I'm not going to do something that's going to keep a kid from being able to shoot.
Oh, hell no, because that's the future, you know. That's the future of the Second Amendment anyways.
I agree. You know, we had a competition shooter, an Appleseed competition shooter come through the other day, and he bought up a bunch of Super X and some Midas Plus.
Yeah, he bought some match ammunition. Now, that's one thing that you can find on the shelf is a higher, you know, higher quality, higher cost match ammunition, like the Lapua Center X, the Midas L,
Plus.
The Midas Plus now. I mean, they've changed it now, but we've got some of the Ely Plus or whatever it is over there. I mean, but that stuff's, you know, $20 for 50 shots, but it's uber refined, high grade match quality ammunition, but it's not something you want to go out and just plink.
Yeah.
But it's not something that's in demand. But, you know, like you said about bringing the ammo in, it's just one of those things. I mean, we had like one brick of Federal Champion come in, the auto match, I think is what it's called. It's the Federal Auto Match. It's a 325 round brick. Yeah. We had one brick come in.
Yeah.
And that's it.
One brick. So, you know, kind of put the shoe on the other foot, guys. So what we're getting at here is, so say that, you know, we get the ammo in stock here at work. And, I mean, we're shooters. We need 22 ammo. Of course it's easy for an employee to go, all right, well, that just came off the truck. I need 22 ammo. Snatch.
Yep.
And put it aside. And, of course, those bricks can disappear. But we try to just maintain a little bit higher level of courtesy for our customers.
Well,
when we get bricks in, we put them out for sale. We price them as cheaply as we can.
Not only courtesy, but professionalism. I mean, that is one thing that separates, and I know Barry has mentioned this in the past, about big box and mom and pop. That's one thing that separates mom and pop shops from big box shops. You've got people in mom and pops that are really dedicated to the customers that come in here because this is what they make a living at, you know, and this is what, I mean, this is what runs the industry, is these small businesses, just like what, you know, just like the Mosses have here. But you got these big box places too, and I've got kind of a direct beeline with some folks who say, you know, like I told you earlier, that some of the management and whatnot is hoarding the ammo, but what we think is happening, I mean, Federal, just for example, Federal, you know, they produce the the Federal Champion Ammunition, the 22, they produce CCI, all the mini mags and the other CCI ammunition out there.
Sure.
They are running basically 7 days a week producing ammunition.
And somebody's getting it.
Somebody's getting it, whether it be at the retail level, but it might be higher up at the distributor level. I mean, the distributors might be getting in 50 pallets of 22 ammunition, but then they're putting like 10 to the side just for employee purchase or whatever the case may be.
Or
like,
or speculation.
Yeah, or speculation or distributor wholesale or some kind of backdoor deal or whatever the case may be. There might be some shady stuff going on.
Or the Department of Homeland Security could be buying it up and pouring it in the English Channel or in the Marianas Trench, for all we know.
For all we know, it could be the case, but it's all speculation right now. But we do know that Federal is producing ammo basically 7 days a week. So they don't have like, okay, we're going to run 22 ammunition for 3 hours today and we're not going to start it up until next week. No, they are producing 22 ammo all the time. So
that's
the
right.
Supply is out there. Where it's going is anybody's best guess.
Yeah,
so, but it's just the lack of professionalism on these retailers' part as far as just hoarding that ammunition in the back and keeping it off the shelves for the customers is just atrocious. And
yeah,
it's just very disrespectful to the customers out there.
It is. So. Well, Mike, we appreciate the idea for the Gun Gripe. This has been an excellent Gun Gripe, and I know that we kind of drug this one out, but there are a lot of thoughts that kind of get provoked. I mean, you're thinking about, you know, ways to allow you and your family to shoot more 22. Where are you going to come up with it? You have to buy it somewhere. And guys, the best advice I can give is just, try to treat your buddies well. If you got a neighbor that needs 22 ammo, help him out. Sell him a brick of ammo or do Clayton County for you.
Clayton County, baby.
All right, ready. So guys, in closing, I mean, the best advice I can give is that if you've got a neighbor or somebody in need that needs 22 ammunition, sell them a brick of 22 ammo and don't sell it at the stupid price. Make sure your friends have ammo to shoot. Do what you can to take care of people in your circle, your neighbors, your friends, and we'll get over this stuff, you know. If you see a box of 22 ammo on the shelf, don't buy it, you know. Unless you need it to shoot, let someone else get that ammo that needs it to go and shoot with it. That's my take on it.
Well, yeah, I mean, you got to think, you know, 22s are what a lot of us got started shooting. So if you buy that ammo just to sit back in your closet and hoard it and keep it, then you're keeping some kid out there from learning to shoot who might be a future competitive shooter, might be a future Olympian, or might be a very fervent Second Amendment supporter in the future just from that one box of 22 ammo getting them started.
Yeah,
so you got to think about the future when it comes to that kind of stuff, not just the here and now.
Yeah,
so it's something that everybody needs to put in their minds and think about.
For sure. So. Well, Mike, we appreciate that idea. That was a great Gun Gripe. I know we kind of drug out a little bit on the time, but we appreciate you watching our video today. And I was thinking about Barryisms. I know we try to close, you know, each video with a Barryism. We're kind of running out of them to some degree. But one of my favorite things that Barry used to do is he'd walk up and he'd go, "Hey, you want to see where the Indian shot me?" And he'd pull up his shirt, and then he'd go, "Want to see where the exit wound is?" And then he'd turn around.
Yeah, so, the belly button and then the exit wound.
Yeah.
Barry.
Anyway, guys, we appreciate your support today. We have many more Gun Gripes on the way. Thanks for watching.
Thanks, guys.